It's game week 29, and this is your one-stop shop for everything Fantasy Premier League. Where's James?
Welcome home, everybody. Welcome home.
I've arrived.
Really excited about this show. It's going to be great. Good to see you. See you, my guy. You all right? Lots of stats, information, value to be offered. God, this is itchy.
I like the attitude, James.
Yes, the attitude, you got to show. You got to embrace these things. I did lose, and that's fine. And with you, my sweet prince, and you, the FPL fairy godmother, we're going to get through this show. It's going to be a great show, and then we will never speak about this ever again. On this week's show, with great performances from Norwich, Watford, and West Ham last week, which relegation-threatened assets should we be looking at in the final 10 games of the season?
We're talking strategy for game week 29 and 31 as this week's FPL pundit shares his tips.
I mean, for me, I wasn't going to use the free hit chip in game week 31.
And with the Manchester derby this weekend, we debate who is the better fantasy asset, Bruno Fernandes or Kevin De Bruyne. So you can only have one, quick answer. De Bruyne or Fernandes?
Welcome back to the show, Dave. How are you doing?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't expect this. I think I feel all right. Yeah.
Bad? You like it? Suits
it? Yeah, I mean, it's the choker that really adds to it.
This week's FPL conundrum is pretty simple. Who is the highest scoring player with less than 10% ownership? Any ideas, boys?
I think this is obvious, but I don't think either of you will get it.
So it's only obvious to you.
That sounds rude, to be honest.
While the guys write down their answers, make sure you hit subscribe and click that notification bell so you don't miss a single FPL FY episode.
The other reason why you want to click that bell is because you can be asking questions that get onto the show with a quickfire community question. Dave, are you ready? Here we go. Dizzy email. Who is the best captain for the next game week? Answer the question because it's quickfire from the community.
Kevin De Bruyne.
Very good. HRJ77. Going to triple up on Wolves. Which combo would be best?
Doherty, Jimenez and Jota.
Sian Aloyd. What should I do with Jamie Vardy?
I'd hold him for this game week.
Answers.
Plenty of questions to be answered, and a massive one is, why are you dressed as Cinderella today?
Oh, yeah, so for those of you new to the show, me and Rambo go head-to-head every single month. You are now 2-1 up after winning last month. The forfeit was me, or whoever lost, wearing a Cinderella outfit. And that is what I am obviously wearing right now, David. Both of you seem quite confused. Eyes at all times, please. Eyes at all times. Vardy was the big problem for me as well this week because he got injured. Quick injury update on him. People struggling to take me seriously. Quick injury update on Vardy is that he should be fine for Aston Villa this weekend. Talking of Manager of the Month competitions, we've got one for you guys. We've got the FPL FYI League, which you can join, and you want to join it this week because you can win a prize, Rambo. What prize can they win?
The FPL FYI mug, which actually would be the first one that doesn't belong to the table. It would actually be the first one that actually goes out to you guys.
That's a high quality mug, that.
The flavour, yeah. So much better.
So the code is on the screen right now. There's a link in the description as well if you want to join our league. And if you have the most points this month, you could win one of these mugs. The big news this weekend was Liverpool losing that unbeaten run. Josh Murray asked this question. Do you think 3 LFC assets is still essential when using your wild card? Now the invincible record is gone. Rambo, you're a Liverpool fan. What was your reaction to that defeat?
In all fairness, being completely honest, I had a feeling it was coming. We've been talking about it a little bit that Liverpool have slowly been maybe looking complacent, not quite at it. And then, of course, there's the Jordan Henderson injury, which everybody should now know that without him, things just don't go to plan. Mm. But when it comes to an FPL perspective, Liverpool have lost one game this season. I think a lot of people are going, lost one league game, it's a big problem. It's a blip, everything else. When a team's playing at such a level, I think you begin to have that understanding that they're always going to be at that level. And the second something goes wrong, people panic. You have to have the Liverpool triple up. Most points this season, Liverpool just going to still walk the league. Doesn't matter what anyone says, Liverpool will walk the league.
And I think the crucial thing with all of this, in terms of your wildcard, if you haven't used it yet, is that FA Cup defeat. Mm. Because now you're in a better place if you've got Liverpool assets, isn't that right?
Yeah, from a fantasy perspective, the fact that Liverpool lost that game is really, really helpful because it just makes game week 31 a little bit easier to navigate without the use of a free hit chip. Because we've all got 3 Liverpool players, so it means now everybody's contingent of active players in game week 31 has gone up by 3, which is a massive amount. And the key thing is you'd be quite confident captaining most of the Liverpool triple up. It's against Palace, so you could if your triple up includes Alexander-Arnold, you can captain him too. Salah or Mane, or even Firmino, any of those players can have a good haul against Palace, and it could be what props you up in that game week. And of course, those of us who've wasted our free hit chip, Rambo, don't have to worry about it anymore.
Definitely wasn't wasted, Dave. I remember when you were on the show, you were telling me not to use it, not to use it, not to use it. it has now turned out to be a masterclass because Liverpool are back in it. So you've got 3 year players, and you were saying to me in that game week 31, you're going to have 4 players who are going to walk all over you. That's not the case anymore. And I think for a lot of people, the concern actually is, what do we do with the rest of our chips? I only have 1 left, which I'm completely fine with, let me tell you, Dave. Weston 1878 says, when is the best time to wildcard? Hussein says, if we have not used a free chip yet, when will be the right time to do so?
So, I mean, for me, I wasn't going to use the free hit chip in Game Week 31.
Because you've been hoarding all your chips, haven't you?
I've been hoarding them. I mean, you have to use them in the kind of the last 10 game weeks. I mean, triple captain was a bit different because we got an opportunity that came up with Liverpool. Some more will come up. But for me, looking at 31, even if we think there's going to be maybe 4 or 5 games in that, it's not very many games. So if you do free hit then, which is not a bad thing to do, but if you do free hit then, you've got a very small pool of players to choose from.
Time for a bit of 60-second surgery. You guys have sent us your teams and we are going to work our way through them in 60 seconds per team. So let's get the time on the clock and let's get started in 3, 2, 1. Aisha Acton says, what to do with Traore, what to do in general, because to be honest, all I see is red arrows on the regs, meaning regular, hashtag on the decline. Dave, hit us up.
Yeah, so I mean, Traore right now, I mean, I'm concerned about his shoulder. I think Wolves probably are as well. It keeps popping out. Yeah, it keeps popping out on the regs. So, you know, I couldn't trust that he was going to start this week. And with that much money in the bank, I think you could probably get to Nicolas Pepe for this double game week. And then you'd have Pepe and De Bruyne for a double game week, which I think could help you arrest the decline.
The one thing I would say is that if you want to save, look, it's 4.2 million in the bank there that you've got. If you want to keep Traore in, if they're going to just deal with the pain and he's going to play, you've got those game weeks coming up. So you want to have as many Wolves assets as possible. So maybe put in Saka because he's got double game week this week and save the money for now. Rambo.
I can't help but stay on the Bruno bike. Bring in Bruno for Traore, and then I'd personally actually take a -4 to get in either Saka or Pepe or any Arsenal asset possible. But Traore has to go. Hopefully not on the decline.
Time!
Thanks, James.
Okay, next up in 3, 2, 1. Colo, FPL. Not happy with a few players. Do I go with wildcard or a -4 hit? That's Dunk for and Dendonka for Alonso and Decore, saving wildcard for the double game week and the blank game week. He's 22K in the world, so it's not bad. What do we think?
Well, he's doing pretty well. However, I am a risk taker, although a loyal risk taker. I would actually risk it all, hit that wild card button because you need more players in the double game week. So I'd take out Willian, I'd bring in Pepe, I'd take out Van Dijk, downgrade to Gomez to save some cash. I would take out Dunk if you can afford Alonso. I'd take out Madison because his time is up as well. I'd bring in someone cheaper. I'd definitely take out Vardy. That time is definitely done. And move maybe to Ings. I think that form might come back. Or Jota or Aubameyang, depending on how much cash you've got. Wild card, baby. James?
If you believe in Leicester, then stick with those Leicester assets. I don't mind the Chelsea as well. I like the moves that you're going to make here. Do that. Dave?
Take the -4, don't wild card.
And with 5 seconds to spare.
Risk it.
Because of blank game, we thought you wanted to wild card before it.
That's still out of a second. Unbelievable stuff from Dave.
Hi!
Welcome back to Pundit Wars, where we're joined by this week's guest, Pundit David Monday from Plymouth. David, how are you doing? Are you well?
Yeah, I'm very good, thanks. Had a little bit of an embarrassing turnout last time I did Pundit Wars, but I've been swatting up and I think I'm ready to smash the records this time.
That's great news. We're smashing it as well. Lovely jacket, bro.
Thanks, mate. Yeah. Had a few changes this week, haven't
we? Yeah, gone all out. Well, you know what Pundit Wars is all about. I'm going to quickly explain it for you. It's very simple. We will give Tave 2 options. He has to then choose one, and as he goes along, he's got to bank to accumulate his score. It's very simple, and after every single answer, he's going to say this.
Bank! It's very, very simple, Dave. As you know, obviously you struggled last time. Hopefully this time you've figured it out. David Monday, hopefully today will be your day. Okay, you need 20-odd points if you want to get off the bottom of the Pundit League table. Do you understand the concept of this game? And are you impressed by our jackets?
Yes, and they're all right.
Jealous. Right, here we go. If you want to play at home, then please, please do. We're basing this on who has the most points. And we will begin in 3, 2, 1. Jota or Pepe?
Jota.
Correct.
Fleck or Wilson?
Fleck.
Correct.
Harry Wilson or Harry Wilson or Wijnaldum, sorry.
Harry Wilson.
Correct.
Jorginho or Noble?
Jorginho.
Incorrect.
Lewis Dunk or Harry Maguire?
Harry Maguire.
Incorrect.
Connor Cody or Johnny?
Cody.
Correct.
Lucas Moura or Ismail Assar?
Moura.
Incorrect.
Rodri or Lacazette?
Lacazette.
Incorrect.
Josh King or Pablo Fornals?
Fornals.
Correct.
Dendonka or Aki?
Dendonka.
Correct.
Bank.
Declan Rice or Nicolas Otamendi?
Right.
Incorrect.
Webster or Joelinton?
Webster.
Correct.
Bernard or Trezeguet?
Bernard and Bank.
Correct. We knew!
Kovacic or Holgate?
Kovacic and Bank.
Time! That was good. He came prepped.
Didn't even get
that
the answer.
Was so intense.
Very good, David. Very
so
good.
Intense.
So, David's score has been checked and verified, and we can go to the answers right now. Rambo, you've got it, haven't you?
It's pretty impressive. 17. Much better than the first time. The man from Plymouth performs. Transfer news. We spoke heavily about Bebeto and Fernandes last week. They're the two most transferred players in this week. We will touch on them in a lot more detail later this show. But Diego Jota has been taking the headlines. And Siddharth said, should we double up on Jota and Jimenez or just stick with one?
I mean, a lot of people will probably be happy to go with one, but I do think there's a viable strategy to go with both. Sometimes when you have a high-owned player like Jimenez, sometimes when he scores, it doesn't really do anything for you kind of green arrow-wise. But if you combine it with the form player at his club that is quite often involved in either assisting him or Jimenez will assist Jota, then you can double up on a lot of the goals that they score. And some people might think, well, you know, Wolves don't normally blow too many teams away, they're not going to score too many goals. But for me, it's not about the team, it's about the players themselves. And both of those two players in the last four matches are in the top five in the Premier League for shots in the box and for big chances. So, because you invest in players in FPL, not teams. So I think doubling up is a great opportunity for anyone who needs to soar up the rankings. I think it can work.
Moving on to players that have been transferred out, Rambo, I'm going to have a tough conversation now. Siddharth Pai says, should I replace Danny Ings with DCL? Now, Danny Ings is one of the most transferred out players this week. You've had him for a long time. You've also got DCL as well. One goal in six.
The love affair doesn't go away. I'm a longevity kind of guy, so I'm going to stick with it. I think if you look at earlier in the season, Ings was in and out of the side. Ralph Hasenhüttl said he wants to get him fully fit. I actually think they're doing that again with him. I think they're just trying to get him fully fit because they know he's so important to that team. And then the other side of it is, I mean, I have both. So I don't think Ings for DCL is the best switch. I think Ings' fixtures are pretty good. Newcastle at home, Norwich away, Arsenal at home. And this season he has been fixture-proof. He scored against all the big sides. The worry with DCL is the fixtures, but then also he's now proven a little fixture-proof as well.
Yeah, so if you have that same thought process that you had with Danny Ings earlier in the season, is the feeling now that DCL is like Danny Ings 2.0, where you can trust him now? There's no way that Danny Ings comes out your side. Because he's 7.2 million as well. So
yeah, but I got him really cheap. So I know that. I think the key thing is, if you got him for cheap, you've got to keep him. It's similar to the whole Vardy debate as well. And any debate, as soon as you get him cheap, you've got to stick with him because it's a waste of money. And also...
But isn't it their money to a point to be made because he's exceeded expectations so much?
But who do you get? Who do you get instead of Danny Ings if you've got him for cheap? That would be my thing. I know last week you were on about Shane Long.
I think Jota's a shout as well.
I think with 9 Game Week 31 coming up, I think Jota or Jimenez is a good out for Ings because they've got quite good fixtures coming up and they definitely have a game in 31, but Southampton don't. So I think a lot of people would make that could make that switch.
James, you did very well last week. Let's roll that VT.
West Ham are finally coming to the FPL party. I'm not sure if they're going to stay up, but I think they have to win this game against Southampton. And I think there'll be FPL returns for Antonio, Noble and Jared Bowen. At me when it happens. Yeah, this is the closest probably any of us have got. Because with at me when it happens, you've got to go bold. I felt like I did. Noble let me down. I was hoping for a penalty, but it was pretty close. I was pleased with that.
Matty, JC, you've absolutely smashed it. Like, you've got some magic ball, crystal ball. Watford will win against Liverpool. Saar will score and Deeney will as well. That is absolutely incredible. What have you gone for this week, Dave?
128 points this season, owned by 17% of fantasy managers, but no goal at Anfield this season for Roberto Firmino. But I do think that's going to change in game week 29 when Bournemouth come to Anfield.
Ismaïla Sarr tormented Liverpool and he's going to do the same to Crystal Palace, a second double-digit haul on the trot, but Watford won't win. At me when it happens.
It's going to be back-to-back, blank-to-blanks for Newcastle United. 0-0 last week against Burnley. It's going to be another 0-0 this week against Southampton. That means get Lascelles in your team right now. At me when it happens. We're going to focus now, when it comes to our watch list, on the teams that are being threatened by relegation. And look at some of the assets, because it is that time of the season where it all gets a bit crazy. Teams like Watford, who are down there, beat the best team in the world. And so we're going to have a look at it now and look at the assets. Because if you look at the dream team, there's three sort of couplets there of players who are in, you know, the bottom five. So when we look at them, we're going to answer a couple of questions. One, who's going to score the most points out of these assets down the bottom? And at the end of this bit, we're going to have to answer which three teams are going to get relegated. So let's kick off with 15th place at the moment, Brighton and Hove Albion.
Yeah, so I mean, their fixtures are really quite tough going into the end of the season, and they have been struggling for goals as well. But that's not for lack of trying. So when we come to this sort of time of the season, you're right, it's really important for fantasy managers to look at what's not just what's happening at the top of the table, what's happening at the bottom. If a team is making a lot of effort to try and stay up, then often that can be a good source of investment. And that's why I think Mopay could be a bit of a differential, because actually in the last four matches, he's had the same number of shots on target as Calvert-Lewin with 9, which is a huge amount, considering that that's the joint best in the whole league in that period. The problem with, that he has had is that even though he's matching DCL for the accuracy, the goal conversion is very low. He basically is finding the goalkeeper quite often, or that someone's blocking the shot. But that to me just tells me the goals are going to come. If a player is shooting and the shots are on target, but they're being blocked, surely at some point he'll come up against a defence that won't block them.
That's one goal in his last 11 games. Fixtures: Wolves, Arsenal, Leicester, United.
Yeah, they are
massive,
very tough.
One against Norwich. But West Ham also have difficult fixtures.
Yeah, well, it was a great victory for them against Southampton. They've probably got the worst fixtures. Yeah. It's them and Brighton and Aston Villa have just got horrible, horrible fixtures. But what I saw in that game against Southampton was what we've been screaming at for ages, to get Haller some support. Yeah. Jared Bowen, they went actually with a front four. Antonio was superb, created so many chances for them. Jared Bowen got himself his first goal. And he scored a lot of goals in the Championship. So I think he can carry on that form and that confidence into the Premier League. And Fornals as well. Fornals is one that people haven't really spoken about a lot, but they took Anderson and put him on the bench because he probably wasn't putting that work together. But when you've got the legs of Jared Bowen and Antonio getting up there with Haller, and then you've got Fornals threading it through, we're going to talk about Man United in a bit. It's a similar kind of feeling where you've got that guy in that sort of number 10 role who can help move it forward. So I think they're going to get a lot better. I think Antonio is a good asset, 6.9, maybe a touch expensive, especially when you've got Arsenal, Wolves, Spurs, Chelsea in the next four game weeks. After that, you've got an okay run of games, but they're teams that are down there and battling. So I worry about West Ham a lot based on their fixtures alone, but there were some shoots of hope with those three. Jared Bowen, Antonio and Haller will obviously be up there. And keep an eye on Fornals as well.
And they were superb against Liverpool as well, as were Watford. Now, obviously, we've mentioned this probably 14 times already this episode, but I've said for a long time, momentum at this stage in the season is critical. I think they got past that new manager bounce and everyone thought, that's it now, they're going to fall off a cliff.
Yeah.
And that's not happened. They've kind of like been a little bit rocky, but
they were on a bad run until that win.
Yeah, but then I think at this stage of the season, you win one of those, and bear in mind who they won it against. If you beat, like, West Ham beat Southampton, but Southampton weren't particularly good, and they turned up against Liverpool and battered Liverpool.
Yeah.
So, and Ismail Assar's back and he's fit, and we were mentioning about Troy Deeney and Ismail Assar, that could be a lovely link-up. And their fixtures are horrific. Crystal Palace, Leicester are not in great form, haven't won a game in 2 months. Burnley, Southampton, these are winnable games. And I think Ismail Assar, 6.3 million, is a standout performer there. He's relatively cheap. A lot of people have Mount and several other assets. I think if you want to go bold, Ismail Assar, I feel like it's a big
deal. Who's the better asset out of these two, Deeney or Sarr?
For me, I'd go for Sarr. When you think about the fact that he's the midfielder as well, he's going to get more points for the goals he scores. I think he's going to get more assists because his assist potential is a lot higher. Deeney's very good at kind of knocking the ball down, but in terms of open play, threading that pass through, Sarr does that better and creates big chances too. And of course, Watford do really well for clean sheets at home as well, so that's another additional point.
Moving on to Bournemouth. They got a good draw against Chelsea, still conceding goals, still struggling a little bit. Who do you see as an asset if they can turn it around? Because they've got the players.
Yeah, I mean, there's quality there and there's experience of the Premier League for a number of years. I mean, I am a little bit concerned about them because I never really know what to expect from them. They're a very patchy team. They can go on a couple of weeks where they get some good results and they typically frustrate Chelsea. I mean, Chelsea is a team that they must hate playing against Bournemouth.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's a few other teams that find that when they play Bournemouth too. I reckon maybe Josh King is someone who can maybe sort of drag him out of this sort of situation. The only problem that he's having at the moment is that he's playing on the wing quite a lot.
Takes penalties.
And he does take the penalties, but I mean, there's not as much trickery in this team as there used to be. So are they going to win too many more? I'm not too sure. I mean, the problem is a lot of their creativity sometimes is coming from their defence now that Ryan Fraser's not really kind of providing it. So Jack Stacey's got some good stats. Last four, he's got the highest expected assists out of all defenders in the last four game weeks. But I really just don't trust their defence. I've got to be honest, there's not a lot I'm seeing at Bournemouth that I can trust, because sometimes they have good results, sometimes they have bad ones. And the fixtures are quite iffy. So Liverpool away, I think, is going to be a tough one. Palace at home, I think that's going to be a tight game. Wolves away, that's going to be tough. When they play Newcastle as well, I mean, Newcastle will make themselves hard to beat in that one, because they know that's the kind of game they're going to go and make themselves hard to beat. And then it's Man United, Spurs, Leicester, Man City.
It's patch there. A lot of the other teams you mentioned have a nice patch after the first four, and it's going to get dogged after that.
But Bournemouth just don't have a nice patch. They've just kind of got iffy and then awful. And then,
I mean, Aston Villa, they don't have a good patch at all. It's difficult, easier, difficult.
Yeah, the question about them getting relegated or being in danger of getting relegated, that's one question. In terms of assets, I think it's really obvious. I think you've got Samatta, who's come in and done well. He's a good finisher. Jack Grealish is the obvious other one. The third most chances in 2020 after Madison and De Bruyne. I think it's as simple as that. If you're going to go for anyone at Aston Villa, it's only those two.
It's strange you say that, because you've been itchy by the last 6 weeks.
And I got rid of Grealish last week as well, obviously because of the League Cup final. But I worry for Villa. Yeah. And it's all on his back.
A lot of pressure on one player.
If they're to stay up, it's down to him, and it's down to Samatta finishing off those chances that he creates, because no one else really does that.
And of course, this Newcastle game in 31 is not happening now because of the FA Cup. So, I mean, with Grealish, he's obviously just had a blank and he's going to have another one. If you're going to have Grealish, I'd do it sort of after those blanks are kind of out of the way.
Bottom of the pile.
Yeah, well...
Norwich, do you believe? You've got your Norwich screen on?
I mean, it's definitely not this green. I feel bad for Norwich because they're so far behind now. If they were a little bit closer...
6 points?
But 6 points
best
at this
fixtures.
Stage... But yeah, but 6 points at this stage in the season is a long 6 points, because you're hoping other teams drop points. And this weekend was absolutely bonkers. Every single team's picking up points. So they must have won that game against Leicester and thought, so sorted, Watford go and win, Bournemouth get a point. It makes it more difficult. And their fixtures are nice, but they just don't have goals in them. Now, I'm looking at Max Aaron and Jamal Lewis, and we saw them two link up for that goal. A lot of people went, fullback getting assists and goals, that's amazing. But when you're at the bottom of the pile, you need your striker scoring. Yeah. I think every other team we've mentioned, you've got Saar, you've got Deeney, you've got King, you've got Grealish, you've got Samatta. You look at Norwich and they're struggling for goals. They did well to keep a clean sheet against Leicester, but Leicester haven't been playing very well, and they've conceded 51 goals this season. So if you're shipping goals, you're not scoring goals, you're in big, big trouble.
Right, let's answer these two questions then. So which player of the players that we've spoken about do you see scoring the most points between now and the end of the season?
I think for me, no-brainer, Ismaïla Sarr. I think momentum's so big, scoring two against the best team in the league. Watford looked really good. They'll win a few more games. And I think we've seen Grealish. The reason you're itchy, I think when you watch Grealish, Villa are now starting to tail off, and they're just trying to find him for every single thing. And he literally is carrying that weight on his back by himself. The Cantwell days are gone. The Pukki days are gone. Ismaïla Sarr, 6.3 million. He's an absolute bargain. What do you reckon, Dave?
I completely agree. I've gone with Sarr as well. He's in my team at the moment for like so many reasons that fantasy managers love to have. He's a player that shoots a lot, especially in the box, creates big chances too. He just kind of does everything.
I'm going to stay with Watford. I'm going to go with the other guy. I'm going to go with Deeney. Just because he takes the penalties, I think he's such a talisman for that club. I think if they're going to stay up, he's going to be integral to how they play, both with Decore in front of him and Sarr going beyond.
The big question, who's going to get relegated? And it's a horrible question because it's difficult. I think a lot of people, I think you're going to say Norwich. Are you a believer? You've been a believer all this season.
Deep down, I am a believer. And I feel like these things do happen sometimes. It's totally my heart with Norwich. My head, I'm going to go with my head it. I think Norwich are obviously in the most danger because of that. I think Bournemouth, I feel like they're running out of steam a little bit. I do feel like that. Despite the good players that they've got, I think they're going to struggle. And the last one, I'm going to go a bit random here. I don't think you guys will be picking this. West Ham, I'm going to go with. I worry about the fixtures just because they've got tough games now, and then they've got the guys around them. I think it's going to be so difficult. That last game against Aston Villa as well, it could go all the way down to that. I know you've said that in the past. I worry about West Ham, I do.
I'm going to stick with you and say, I want to be a believer, but Norwich have got to go. They're just not scoring goals. Every time I watch them, I find them frustrating because, as you mentioned, they don't create chances. So I feel like they're unfortunately going to go down. Then I think it'll be Brighton. I actually think they're going to get sucked down. They're not scoring. They're conceding a lot of goals. it feels they're playing like they're really safe. They're playing like they've got 50 points, and I don't like that. Like, you can't get complacent in a relegation dogfight, and their fixtures aren't particularly nice, especially after that Wolves game. And then I actually think this is going to go right down to the final game of the season. I reckon West Ham and Villa will be either a point apart or something like that, and they'll go head-to-head. Whoever loses goes down. And actually, as a neutral, I want to see that. Like, I want to see that battle. And then I'm going to back... I mean, it's a toss of a coin, but I think Aston Villa will go down on the final day. Mikel Antonio, West Ham to win it. What do you reckon?
At you when it happens, yeah? yeah. Book that in for the future. Yeah. I agree with you on Norwich. I mean, there isn't really that much hope, I think, in all areas of the pitch for them. I think Bournemouth, I agree with you as well. I think they're kind of running out of steam at both ends of the pitch. I've never really trusted them defensively, and I just don't really think I could trust any of sort of the individuals across their attack to really be that guy that just pulls them out. So if you're conceding goals, not confident you're going to score them, I think that's going to suck them down. And then for me, the last one I'm going to go with Brighton as well. Every year you always see a team that thinks they're safe, and we all kind of thought they were safe, and they'd been playing some nice football, so you know, everything's fine. But actually, yeah, if you're not picking up those points, you can get sucked in. There's enough drive behind Watford and West Ham, and I do think Grealish is the type of player who can carry Aston Villa out of the situation. I don't really see that at Brighton. And yeah, conceding goals, not scoring too many. I think they are just going to get sucked in and maybe also go down on the last day.
Huge game this week in the Manchester derby, Manchester United against Manchester City. And we are going to touch on this a little bit later. It's Bruno against KDB. My boy Bruno has been coming up trumps. But James has some details on the formations and how Manchester United might
and
play.
And I'm jumping on whatever, if it's a train or a car.
It's a bike now, it's a bike.
Okay, I'm on the Bruno bike, and so should you be. Because if you look at the heat maps from the Everton game, which was the last game they played, drew 1-1. I think everyone's been watching Bruno Fernandes. Last week you went big on him and said, do it now. I said, wait a couple of weeks. The reason for that was because of this game. But if you look at the heat maps, what you can see is the formation that they're probably going to set up with against Man City is the same one that they've been using and getting the best out of Bruno Fernandes. The big reason it works and the big reason why you should be excited by the front three options of Man United is because of the split of the front two. Anthony Martial is staying over on that left-hand side. Mason Greenwood, who's probably the bargain striker in the game right now, because he's starting, he only costs 4.3 million and he's playing these games. And the big, big thing is Bruno Fernandes is just on that left side. That's where he's getting on the ball so that he can play in Martial. And when he does that, the cross pass is going to be to Mason Greenwood, who can get himself in the box. You look at the formations of the last game in the League Cup between Man City and Man United. Man United played with three at the back. I think they might do that again this weekend because it gives them a bit more stability. But what that also means is it's all about Bruno Fernandes and it's all about attacking quite narrowly initially in the first phase of the transitions and then getting the ball to Greenwood and Martial, who are playing out wide there. So when it comes to Man United, it is about Bruno Fernandes. But what about Man City? We are Stephen McInerney from Esteem Company.
There's not many safer bets for FPL assets than Kevin De Bruyne, really. He's great for a goal or an assist, so he's a pretty obvious one. He's always good for a big game, but then there is the issue of the Pep roulette. You never know who's going to play. Other than him, maybe someone like Bernardo Silva is usually good for a goal in a derby, and then maybe someone like Riyad Mahrez. Obviously, it depends who's going to play, but I would say stick with Kevin De Bruyne.
Steve is obviously backing Kevin De Bruyne. He loves him. He thinks he's the main man. For me, as I've said, me and Bruno got that attachment. Since day one when he arrived, there was something there. Beard gang, I don't know what it was. I was on the Bruno bike early. But the job in FPL is to find out who's the most important asset, and especially for this game. And he's been in incredible form. 16 goal attempts since he's arrived. He's only been here less than a month. He's absolutely on fire. And everything seems to go through him. So I'm obviously biased for Bruno. Bruno bike all the way. What do you reckon, Dave?
Yeah, I mean, it's tricky right now because we can look at form, and obviously Bruno Fernandes has that. Everything about Man United is going through him, and he's taking the penalties as well. But at the same time, De Bruyne, I think, has kind of nicer fixtures in the short term. I mean, I keep talking
There's
about
more
how...
more fixtures as well.
Yeah, more fixtures too, because that's the thing, is that De Bruyne has a double game week in game week 29. Bruno doesn't. So if you had neither of these players and you had to pick one for this game week, I'd probably go for De Bruyne because he's going to play a Man United side who I still don't really necessarily trust defensively. Man City have got a good record of winning at Old Trafford in the Premier League over the last few seasons, and then they're at home against Arsenal again, another team with a few defensive issues. De Bruyne's captaincy material this week. Fernandes isn't. So that's short term. Yeah. But long term, when I wildcard, I'd sooner get Fernandes than I would get De Bruyne, because you're absolutely right. When everything goes through one individual player, it's huge. And the thing is, for me, he shoots more often than De Bruyne.
He shoots from outside the box a lot.
But he's accurate. He's really, really accurate.
He is accurate. I think this is a really good question to ask, because it feels like you've got De Bruyne. He's that heavyweight champion. He's been winning it. He's been the main man for a long time. Bruno Fernandes is the challenger because he is integral to them. When you look at the stats with these two, chances created, let's go there. De Bruyne 14, Fernandes 8, and everyone is talking about Fernandes. So when it comes to these two teams, and it'll be the same in the game as well, it's a team that controls the game, and then it's a team that literally plays through Bruno Fernandes. So if you've got a team that's more fluid in Man City, and you know De Bruyne is going to play and he's a key asset, doesn't that still make him a better asset than Bruno Fernandes? Which one's more valuable to you?
Well,
someone who's involved all the time, but still involved less than someone is in part of the team.
I think if we're looking at this particular fixture, you know Man City are going to dominate the ball, and you know Man U are going to play on the counter, which has worked for him against Man City this season. My thing would be, if you look at the Everton game, Everton dominated the second half, and United played on the counter, but even on the counter, Bruno was the most important figure. He had that shot, which was well saved. He had the cross, which was well blocked. So the question that he gets more involved, but is he more accurate? You're saying, is it quantity over quality? Strip all that away. It's about money. And he's much, much, much cheaper. And you have to remember, Arsenal have that double game week. So you could invest that money in Aubameyang, save that money with Bruno. And it's a good save.
Okay, so you can only have one. Quick answer. De Bruyne or Fernandes? Who do you have for the rest of the season?
For the rest of... Oh.
Come on.
Bruno.
Yeah.
Bruno bike.
I'm going to jump off the bike. We were in tandem for a second. I'm jumping off that. I'm De Bruyne the whole season. There's a reason why he's got the most points.
But I still think De Bruyne for the next few weeks, just because he's got
slightly more games. Make your choice, Dave.
We're not allowed to make transfers then?
Well, we can.
That's the whole point of the game.
Not within that world that we were living in. Let's talk about Pep Roulette, because when you look at Man City, we're always worried about which players are going to play. They've got a double game week now. We know that. We've knocked up this graphic where we look at the minutes against the Big Six plus Leicester, which is essentially those big, big games where you're going to want to play your main assets. The three that seem to be the ones with the most minutes are De Bruyne, Raheem Sterling and Bernardo Silva. The same goes when you look just away from home, which of course is where the game is this weekend. When you look at that, is Bernardo Silva a good shout in terms of having that second Man City asset?
It is tricky because when you do look at the numbers here, Bernardo Silva is still a fair way away from De Bruyne. De Bruyne is the clear champion of not getting rotated. And when you consider some of the other factors we've got to really think about with blank game week 31 coming up, some of us haven't got a free hit chip to fall back on. Making these transfers to bring in additional Man City players who aren't going to play then, when you're not even confident they're going to play in the double, it just feels a bit much. So I do think if you're going to invest in Man City, you just need one, and it's De Bruyne.
So Dave, you don't fancy a Manchester City double up, but you've got a double up of Arsenal in your weekly wildcard.
Yeah, I mean, I think the fixtures for Arsenal look nicer than they do for Man City, which is really what underpins it. But also, we can be less concerned about rotation with Arsenal because they're out of Europe now. And really, the best way they can make sure they have European football next season is to win these big games and finish in the top four or five or whatever it takes to finish in the Champions League this season. Aubameyang, obviously, completely unrotatable player. He's 5 points off Vardy for being the top scoring forward. He was top scoring forward last year as well. So if you get a double game week with Aubameyang with some really, I still think they're nice fixtures. West Ham, it could be tricky, or Arsenal's form at home has been very good, so I think they could push through that. And Man City without Laporte, I still think they can score there. There's reasons to think he can have a good game week, but if you're kind of worried about what the majority can hurt you with, then, you know, captaining him could be a safe bet. Although I do still quite like the look of Nicolas Pepe as well. In the last four or five games, he's looked really, really good. If you go back in the last 10 games for Arsenal, only Aubameyang scored more goals than him, and no players assisted more often than Pepe. And he's only sort of played 6 of those 10 games. So that's really, really impressive for that long stretch to still be one of the best Arsenal players within that run. And what you have to remember is that as a midfielder, when he does score, he'll get more points than Aubameyang. I still think he has a greater assist potential than Aubameyang because he's kind of more of a creative player. He's the type of player who can win penalties as well, as we saw in France. And of course, you know, if Arsenal do keep a few clean sheets over, I mean, I think the West Ham game, they could potentially keep, well, they'll get that clean sheet point as well. So Pepe looks like a really, really exciting differential. The points he scored last few game weeks and the fact he's not owned by very many people, I think he looks really good for this game.
Still all to play for in the My Guy League, despite Rambo's constant dominance. We go again, though. This week, I'm going with Jota, I think, against Brighton. They're in just terrible form at the moment. Wolves look so solid, so functional. He's there. He's getting in the box a lot more. He's scoring goals. He's in form. It's Jota for me.
I mean, I was going to pick Jota, but then I was told I wasn't allowed him because you had him.
Rules are rules, babe. Rules are rules.
That's another time when I agree with you. It's just so annoying. I've gone with Pepe. Just all the reasons I've already mentioned already. He looks like a fantastic option. I mean, like I said, midfielders always get more points when they're an attacking threat than the forwards do. And I think we've already picked Aubameyang, so Pepe it is. Two games, why not?
I've stuck with Wolves. I've gone Matt Doherty. I think he's in good form, and Wolves are in good form, and I think they'll win this weekend. And he'll be involved. Time for the FPL conundrum answers, and I'm now suddenly very nervous about James's choice. Can we get the answer, please?
So I went with Marcus Rashford, which is making you sweat a bit because he's injured, but people had him, so they would have sold him, but he got a lot of points.
I've gone with Matt Doherty, who's not really had a too good season, but recently has been fantastic, and I'm thinking that might be why.
What a Roman size. I didn't think it through.
That's your answer to any question.
I didn't think it through. I just backed it and now okay. I feel like I might regret it. But if it is Roman size, I did think it through. What is the answer?
Right. Yes! I'm absolutely buzzing with that. Cannot believe it. I'm also buzzing about the guys from Always Cheating. They're going to be on the show next week, so we might have an earlier show. So make sure you subscribe so you don't miss out.
Also, you need to make sure you check out this week's Uncut with Leander Dendonka. Put a donk on it.
Most likely to release a hip-hop mixtape. Have you got any rappers in the changing room?
Maybe Morgan, Gibbs White.
Yeah?
I do like hip-hop as well, but he's really into hip-hop.